Welcome in the name of Jesus. Today is the third Sunday after Pentecost, and our sermon preaching series is on the Ten Commandments, particularly looking at Martin Luther's explanation in the large catechism, which he wrote for pastors. This is a small catechism for parents to teach their children. And so we'll have an interaction between what Luther has to say about the second commandment, and then we'll be looking also at Galatians chapter 5, our second reading. And in all of this, our Lord God is saying, not that way, but this way. Not negatively, but positively, this is what I want from my people. Let us rise for the confession of sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of gods and Lord of lords, you are the author of the best. Graft into us a love for you. Increase our devotion. Nourish us with what is good. And vigilantly watch over us for whom you care. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Sacred Scripture.
The first lesson is from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19. And the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he departed from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." And he said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" And he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen and sacrificed them and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him, This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me.
I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken.
Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure.
For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption.
You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The second lesson is from Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom. Brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated and turn to page 13 in the inside of your bulletin. Martin Luther's small catechism originally included this section called the Table of Duties, certain passages of Scripture that speak to the various callings or vocations of God's people. And so we will read together to workers of all kinds. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or is free, Ephesians 6:5 to 8, and to employers and supervisors. Masters, do the same to them and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him, Ephesians 6:9. Now, on the previous page at the top of the page, let us pray together. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers and because in our weakness we can do nothing good without you, give us the help of your grace, that in keeping your commandments we may please you both in will and deed, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The text for the sermon is the second commandment in Luther's Large Catechism and an interplay with the epistle lesson from Galatians 5. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So last week, as we began this series, the Ten Commandments tell us what our Heavenly Father wants. And he does so both in negative and positive ways, saying not that way, but this way. And so last week, we learned in the first commandment, you shall have no other gods, that our Father doesn't want us to fear, love, and trust in other gods. And his word declares, and do you remember your line from last week? Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding, Proverbs 3:5. Our Father wants our hearts to be firmly fixed on him. So this week we learn in the second commandment, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, that this means our Father cares about what's on our lips. Who's in our heart, what's on our lips. So this means our Father doesn't want us to use his name for evil, false, or blasphemous purposes, but rather wants us, as Luther says in the Small Catechism, to call upon him with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. So the second commandment is not merely kept by avoiding foul language that invokes God's name as if God's name were damn, but rather we do our Father's will when whom we believe in our hearts, we confess with our lips. So this week, our passage will be from King David, Psalm 145, verse 21. And when I say, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, your response is, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. So my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. So now let's try it. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. One more time to get it. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. Now, you've oftentimes heard the word orthodoxy, two doors down the street, St. Nick's Greek Orthodox Church. The word orthodoxy literally comes from Greek words meaning right praise or right worship. And in theology, orthodoxy bears a sense of right teaching. Its opposite is heterodoxy, which we would translate as wrong praise or other than right teaching. Because our Father wants us to trust him with all our heart, then what is on our lips ought to cohere with who is in our hearts. Right praise of God comes from right trust of God. Therefore, when we trust the wrong things, trust the wrong persons, that will be made known by what's on our lips. So we're going to think about that a bit more clearly, and let's go back to the Large Catechism, and blessed Martin Luther writes there on the second commandment. God's name must not be appealed to falsely, or taken upon the lips while the heart knows well enough, or should know, that the truth of the matter is different. This is what happens with people who take oaths in court, where one side lies against the other. For God's name cannot be misused worse than for the support of falsehood and deceit. Dr. Luther continues, but the greatest abuse occurs in spiritual matters. These have to do with the conscience when false preachers rise up and offer their lying vanities as God's word. So he concludes, now you understand what it means to take God's name in vain. In some it means A, to use his name simply for purposes of falsehood, B, to assert in God's name something that is not true, or C, to curse, swear, use spells, and in short, to practice whatever wickedness one may. So the antithesis then, once again, is to say with King David, rightly using God's name, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. So last week we looked at Galatians, and we remember that St. Paul's letter to the Galatians begins with a rather serious pen lashing rather than tongue lashing, because the church in Galatia has largely fallen prey to the false teaching of preachers who have insisted to them, okay, you Gentiles first have to become Jews in order to be Christians. In the language of today, these false teachers have pushed identity politics on their hearers by insisting that it's something other than holy baptism that is the mark of right relationship with the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And to this, Paul says no. So he clarifies what holy baptism is and what it does and how it is to be lived. That holy baptism does not give us Christians freedom to do whatever we want. Licentiousness is the old-fashioned word, as if we had a license to do whatever we want. So Paul is making clear, holy baptism is not affirmation of how we see or understand our lives in this world somehow apart from God, but rather the Holy Spirit uses the gospel of the servant love of God's Son Jesus, what the Greek word is agape, right? He was crucified to save us from sin and death and the old evil one. And so the Spirit of God calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies through the gospel. So he uses this servant love of Christ, this crucified Christ, to capture our hearts, to put the right words on our lips, to lead us to walk with him. So heterodoxy, which is the wrong kind of love, is not really love, but is rather the narcissistic desires of the old sinner, the old Adam or Eve, who must daily be drowned as long as we're still subject to that unique biological life that began at our conception. In other words, the day they throw dirt on us, that's the day that we don't have to struggle anymore with the old Adam or the old Eve. So, brothers and sisters, sometimes people will say to me, you know, I'm really struggling with this, as if somehow they're a failure because they're struggling with certain things, with wrong thoughts, with wrong desires. And these are the works that Paul says are the evident sins of the flesh. He's really talking about when the old Adam, the old Eve, the old sinner in us is in charge. And when we're struggling against that, this means that the Holy Spirit is actually working on us and working in us. That the Spirit of God is calling us back to our baptism. Luther says it's like a ship. You can always, if you fall overboard, you can always crawl back on. So the Spirit of God calls us back to our baptism, where we have been crucified with Christ. A lot of folks, I think, don't understand that anytime Paul talks being crucified with Christ, as he did earlier in Galatians 2:20, he's talking baptism. We've been buried into Jesus' death and resurrection. So in baptism, what happens is our Father calls us by name. He says, you're a child of God. You're mine. You belong to me. Now, next week, we're going to reason together about the purpose of the Sabbath. That namely, that God calls us out of the world, right? Remember, that's what ecclesia, the church, is. We're called out of the world of false teaching to assemble with God for right praise and right teaching. That, in other words, you can't be a Christian in isolation as if one would have the Holy Trinity and live in a solitary existence. God is a community within himself, and we are never called to a solitary existence, a me and Jesus kind of relationship. So the antidote to the desires of the flesh of the old Adam, the old Eve, will not be found by crawling into our private prayer closet or by sitting in an easy chair with an open Bible. So again, let's confess with King David, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145, 21. Luther wrote that being a parent is the most important calling, the most important vocation, because bringing children into the world delights the Lord God, whose first command was be fruitful and multiply. Now, in 2 weeks, we're going to say more about that as we look at the fourth commandment. Honor your father and your mother, that it may go well with you, that you may live long in the land. And we'll talk about the importance of that marriage of one man, one woman, that is God's good and gracious will. And Luther wrote that parents are bishops and pastors of their own household. That's why he wrote the small catechism for parents, to help them to teach the faith. And so for, I think, 8 or 9 years before sermons, we've been saying a little portion of the small catechism all 52 Sundays of the year. And it's sort of to encourage the parents to help you teach the faith when you go home. But it's also to remind us adults, this is what we ought to have learned from God's word as we were children. Because we're living in a world that's awash in other stories. We would call them false gospels, other stories. Some teachers, many politicians, many entertainers, video games, popular music, many of our children's peers, sadly even many parents, are, as Paul says today, captive to the desires of the flesh. Gallup recently, in a poll, talked about the dropping number of people in the country who believe in God. And it was fascinating that 32% of Americans in the age group of 18 to 29, 32% say they don't believe in God. And one might wonder, how much larger is that number in those who are coming up behind them? Gallup didn't poll anyone younger than 18. But again, we're awash in so many other stories that many times people are no longer able to recognize the difference between the other stories and God's story. We often say the scriptures are a meta-narrative, one overarching story that is contained in 66 books for those of us who count 39 Old Testament books, and a few more for those who use the Greek Old Testament, the Septuagint. So, now, before our Lord ascended, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he was speaking to 120 disciples that included both men and women, and you'll remember what he said to them, "You shall be my witnesses." Now, we'll paraphrase what he said. "You shall be my witnesses in Southeast North Carolina, in this state, in this nation, and to the ends of the earth." So when we, the baptized, struggle together, come together, struggling together against the desires of the flesh of the old Adam, the old Eve, the old sinner in us, and when we rightly trust God with our hearts, when we confess God with our lips, when we walk with the Lord Jesus in the Spirit, which means walking in agape, servant love, we are witnesses to the triune God. Today, you got up, you answered the Spirit of God's call to be the church, to ecclesia, to come out of the world, to assemble together for worship in this place, and in so doing, you used God's name rightly. There are some who are watching right now who would love to be here, but you're dealing with illness, or you're infirm, or you're shut in, a few yet dealing with COVID in this time. But by gathering with us online, you again are using God's name rightly. You have been called out of wrong teaching into right teaching. This week, when those of you have children in your care, whether as parents or grandparents, when you teach children the meaning of holy baptism, this is who you are and whose you are. When you engage in fraternal conversation with those who have forgotten their baptism, who have fallen away. When you invite those who are unbaptized to come here to assemble with you next week for worship. When you do these things, you will be using God's name rightly. As you do, as Paul is instructed today, to return to your baptism, you will use God's name rightly when you confess to God that my conscience is troubled because there are things that I have done and there are things that I have left undone that are not what you want. I know I have not done what you want. As you walk in the Holy Spirit daily, you will use God's name rightly and you will exhibit the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Notice the contrast between the works of the flesh but the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And what does that look like? Servant love, agape, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and the toughest one for our culture, self-control, delay of gratification. Our vocation, our calling, as the children of God, is clear. We are to be the body of Christ in the world. So let us one more time with King David rightly use God's name. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145:21. Now, maybe you know the chorister's prayer. Father, grant that what we say with our lips, we may believe in our hearts, and what we may believe in our hearts, we may show forth in our lives through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray with the Lord Jesus Christ for the unity and renewal of his church on earth, for Bishops Eaton and Smith, for Francis, Bartholomew, and all bishops, for all pastors, including Samuel Zumwalt, Marvin Shedler, Robert Kuppler, Michael Bergbauer, Joel Kettner, and your servant, for our seminarian, Robert Shivers, for all church workers and musicians, for Stephen ministers, for the people of God, and for all people, according to their needs. Holy Father, grant to your church on earth an extra measure of your Holy Spirit, that the bride of Christ may use your name rightly by calling on you with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Generous Father, we thank you for the birth of Theo Braden Thornburg, and for the gift of every life, born and unborn. Preserve from evil all pregnant women and their babies, especially Sarah Knoll, Brianna Johnson, Lauren Capozio, and their children. We give you thanks for the birthdays of Johanna Hill, Mary Pollard, Art Dingfelder, Kelsey Johns, and Denise Benoit. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, we ask your blessing upon those joined in Christian marriage, that they may be signs of the love Christ has for his bride, the Church. We give thanks for those celebrating wedding anniversaries, Randy and Sheila Mallow, Andy and Liz Rappold, Frank and Marty Felder, Larry and Norma Troutman, and Howard and Lonnie Boyerman. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Compassionate Father, show your kindness and mercy to the Ukrainian people, to earthquake victims in Afghanistan, and to Ed Ludeker, Maureen Ritchie, Rod Andrew, Harry and Carol Kameski, Bill Baldwin, Lauren Thornburg, Elaine Mattis, and Ken Manning. We pray for Jackie Phillips, Lois Coupler, Kay Guder, Patty Messino, Margaret French, and Kay Thompson. For Carolyn Hooker, Megan McKinney, Joel Peterson, Dennis Hall, Bob Benjamin, and Marty Felter. For Barbara Duff, John Tullis, Howard and Lonnie Boyerman, Arthur and Barbara Moore. For Nate Holloway, John Goss, Matthew Hall, Nora Rutland, Peggy Barr, David Hunsberger, Alexandra Schwartz, and Brigitte Walters. We pray for Vivian Alexander, Sue and Terry Miller, Barbara and Don Butzen, Sandra Marshburn, Gretchen Donaldson, Leslie Long, Alice Copeland, Amy Kelm, and for Lacey. For those fighting COVID, for the suffering and the dying, for the grieving, especially the family and friends of Ruth Costello and Luke Rocks, and those we name aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, merciful Father, grant that we who know our hunger and thirst for your Son's true body and most precious blood may always yearn more deeply for your eternal life and love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for a few announcements. Mostly, I'll call your attention to page 15 in the bulletin, where there's some extensive announcements. Just a couple things to highlight. Church members, regular visitors, there are copies of the new phone directory. They have a yellow cover, and they're on a table by the front glass doors. Please, Donna says, take one per household. Chris Kendall's sponsorship forms. Sponsors for our Christmas market, which this year is Saturday, November the 19th. Sponsors help cover the overhead costs and make it a bit more fruitful enterprise. So thank you for those who have offered to be sponsors. Reminder to you that Stephen Ministry has a seminar information meeting on Sunday, July 17th at 9:45 in the church library. You're thinking, maybe God's calling me to be a Stephen minister, I'm not sure, or I'd like to know more about Stephen ministry. That's the meeting for you, again, July 17th at 9:45 in the church library. Last but not least, summer goes quickly. At the end of summer, or near the end of summer, Saturday, August 20th, is our next new disciples class. People come, they say, why do Lutherans do what they do? And this is part of the process for joining our congregation, but no strings are attached to attend the new disciples class Saturday morning, the 20th of August from 9 to noon. So if you're interested, set that date aside and be sure to let Donna know in the church office that you would like to attend. Those are all the announcements. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
For
those not of your household, continue to bow or wave to those.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, you warm and feed us through the faithful shining of the summer sun. We bring these offerings of praise and pray that you will shine on us forever with the brightness of your grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy Lord, God of Savior, heaven and earth in the love flame, shout the glory of your name. Sing Hosanna in the highest, sing Hosanna to the Lord. Truly blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
You are indeed holy, almighty and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Having come into the world, he fulfilled for us your holy will and accomplished our salvation.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and his promise to come again, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. And we implore you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, that we and all who share in this, the true body and the most precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, may be filled with heavenly peace and joy, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be sanctified in soul and body, and have our portion with all your saints. All honor and glory are yours, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in your holy church now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Please remain standing as we sing the Lamb of God.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus Christ.
Christ, who love our Lord.
the true body and most precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, your fingerprints of love are on this world which you helped your Father make. But in this bread and wine you show yourself that we may truly see. By your Spirit, help us trust your saving work, that we may then imprint your love on everyone we meet. With the Father and the Holy Spirit, we bless you, one Lord, one God, now and evermore. Amen. I will strive to pray daily, worship weekly, read the Bible, serve at and beyond St. Matthew's, be in a relationship to encourage spiritual growth in others, and give of my time, talents, and resources.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.